Okay, right. Welcome everyone. I'm going to start. I'm standing in for Cook today as he had a prior engagement that or other engagement that he has to attend to. So I would just like to welcome Carol and Mantua, who is going to be facilitating the learning workshop around evolving evaluation, which is basically building on the last two sessions that we discussed. So the journal club, which Mantua held the previous week, and then also sort of linking to the curriculum mapping that Carol did in the first session. Just another note before we start is that remember that these sessions are coupled three. So it's a journal club, learning tech, and learning workshop that sort of builds on one another. And we will share the program for the rest of the sessions next week. And then the fourth session is a e-portfolio session, as we're trying to, and it's 10 minutes where we sort of present a specific topic around the e-portfolio. And then the rest of the session is for you to start building your teaching portfolio. Okay, right. I'll hand over to Mantua and Carol. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Yanis. Carol will start. I'm in two meetings, so maybe I'll talk to one of the slides, but Carol will start the process. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. You're going to have to forgive me for a second because I'm just going to try and do screen share while... Okay. I might just do it the usual way that I do it. Sorry, I've got PowerPoint online today and it's a bit new to me to be sharing it in this way. Okay, so my apologies. Oh, man. There we go. Okay, so I hope you can all see the presentation. I'm just trying to see. Sorry.
Yes.
Okay, good. I'm afraid I can't make it big because then I can't see any of you or unmute myself or mute myself. So I do apologize for that. So as Yana said, this leads on a bit from the curriculum mapping session, which we did 2 weeks ago, in terms of if we are going to be looking at the alignment of our learning events, our objectives, our teaching methodologies, and our assessment formats, then it's really important that we actually have the students' perspectives of the learning environment that we've been creating. So if we just remind ourselves of the slide that Manto shared last week in the journal club, where she spoke about the importance of student teams in evaluating courses and content, and that we can have different levels of student participation, going from kind of the lowest level where there's no interaction or no input from the students, the curriculum is set by the teachers, all the way through up to the situation where we have the students in control, and going through different levels of student activity within the design process of the course, or in the ensuring that the learning activities and the assessment practices are taking place and are being delivered or being achieved within the course. Just also to remind ourselves of the slide that I shared about some components of a learner-centered curriculum and what does it actually mean to be learner-centered, and taking from Waymer's article those five areas of having a course which is learner-centered, the balance of power being about who gets to determine what, when, where, and how learning takes place. The function of content being that the content is not just about creating a knowledge base for the learner, it's also about skills development and how the learner will use that knowledge, and the relevance of that knowledge to the learner in the future, in their future roles that they will have. The role of the teacher being switching from the teacher-centered view, where the teacher is imparting the knowledge, to the teacher being a facilitator, assisting the student to achieve the knowledge and skills that are aimed for in the learner-centered model. And then also the responsibility for learning is sitting with the learner in the learner-centered model. The learner needs to take the opportunity to set their own goals and determine what learning will take place and how they will achieve the goals and the skills that are required. And I think a really important part of the learner-centered model is the purpose of evaluation. And that then leads to the process of evaluation, that evaluation is not just a grading process to determine whether someone has passed the hurdle to go on to the next level. Evaluation in a learner-centered model is a learning process. It feeds into the learner's learning and how they acquire their knowledge and their skills. Going on to the article that we shared for today, when Manto and I discussed it, we thought that it would be useful for us to look at ways in which we can evaluate a course to determine how learner-centered it is. And despite the literature on learner-centeredness, you will note that the article we shared with you is actually from 1974. And those were the only two that we could really find who had developed items which could be included in a questionnaire. Foster was one of the two that we could find, which could be used to determine learner-centeredness. Now, obviously following on from Manta's session last week, you know, having students involved in reviewing components or in even entire courses, and having student groups who are doing that is really important. But there was a very interesting article that I read, and I'll give you the reference at the end for those of you who want to read it. And it's actually an article from an engineering journal, where they had a very nice process of combining the student groups with a whole course evaluation in the form of a questionnaire, to try to determine how the course could be changed. And one of the points that article make, and that Foster also makes, is the importance of us changing our evaluation from an instructor content focus to a focus of the student experience and the learning performance. With a traditional course evaluation, I'm sure you all love that question of, was the workload manageable for the time that we used to have on those course evaluations that we used to do in paper in the lecture theatres, because nobody ever did well, I think, on that statement. And so it's that shift from, you know, was the content manageable for the time versus did the content contribute to your learning? And those sorts of questions, which help us to see more of the student experience and put the focus on the student rather than on the instructor or the content. So just to Foster and Elderman, having been written before Wehmer's book, have slightly different areas or takes on the five areas that they've identified for student learning, student-centered curriculum. But they link quite nicely with what Wehmer had suggested. So Wehmer suggests the balance of power, as I said, looking at where does that decision-making process around learning reside. Foster and Elderman speak about the basis of power. So what is the the base or the reason for the student viewing the lecturer or the facilitator as powerful or having authority. And they identified five different types of power. And when they go through their process of validating their questionnaire and identifying which items would be related to aspects of student-centeredness, there were two which kind of came out. So there's the coercive power, which is the student perceiving the lecturer as being able to punish. And then there were statements related to the class learning environment and the meaningfulness of the lecture, that there's legitimate power where the student sees the lecturer by the I don't want to say power, but the authority that has been entrusted to the lecturer through the university, as the university identifying the lecturer as a person who is appropriate to teach this course. So that is seems to be important in student-centered courses in fostering personal meaning and class environment. And then the relatability of the student to the lecturer, so referent power. The student views the lecturer or the facilitator as a person of authority because they can relate to them and can feel like they can interact and facilitate learning was also important. So the orange items which I've highlighted on the slide, the five areas which Foster and Alderman start speaking about were derived from the literature, and then through their item analysis, they identified five factors which were important for evaluating a student-centered course. So I've touched on the two or the three of the coercive authority, the positive class environment, the personal meaningfulness, and I've just forgotten the third one, the diffusion of power. So the students being able to have agency within the learning process. And they see this as well with, or another area is the responsibility for learning and self-evaluation. And I think that these tie up quite nicely if we look at Weimar again. Sorry, I'm going around in circles a little bit. You know, in terms of Weimar viewing the function of content as not just providing a knowledge base, but providing skills development, which would give personal meaningfulness to the students if they can see where this content and these skills would be relevant to them. So I'll kind of stop there. And Manta, are you still with us? Or have you had to slip off? Our apologies, she's being called to the same meeting as Prof. Cook.
Yeah, just for a few minutes, I can do the slide and then disappear.
Brilliant.
If I can see. Yes, I can see.
There we go.
Okay. Thank you, Carol. Thank you for that. For the workshop now, the task that we would like you to do is to design an evaluation to assess student-centeredness of a teaching event, a module, or a course. You'll rate Foster and Alderman statements from 1 to 5 as to whether you would include it in your evaluation, 1 being least likely to include and 5 being definitely include. Then you'd also look at how you would adapt the statements to your context, which statements or questions would you choose and why, and what else you would include considering Weimar's approach. So Yanis is going to divide you into groups, I think. I hope we're still there. And then you can meet and do this online. I think there probably should be a Google document, yes. Then you can then work on that and come back for feedback. Enjoy. I hope it's really fun for you. Thank you, Carol. Thank you, Yanis, and everyone.
Okay, thanks, Mantua. Okay, so I'm going to create the breakaway rooms. So you can just join your group, and then obviously if it says group 7, then just fill in your answers in group 7. And once you're done, I'm going to set the timer. Carol, I can't remember what we set the time should be, and then you will automatically come back to the room.
We said about 20 minutes for you guys to discuss. So each of these is a statement from Foster and Alderman's article. I've put the factor which they related it to just in this column here. I hope you guys can still see my screen. And then if you have other items which you would suggest to be included in your evaluation or how it could be changed for your context, then if you can type in those other items below. I'll put the link to the Google Doc into the, into the chat now so that you guys can enter that, click on that to go into the document. And then if you can just allocate one of you to in your group, once you're into your group, to be part of or to be scribe and capture what the group is looking for or what the group is saying. Thanks.
Okay, great. So I'll just give you a minute to open the document, and in that time I will stop, just quickly change the settings.
Just while Yanis is doing that, are there any questions about what you guys will be discussing in the group? Okay, seems like everybody is clear. Cool.
May I ask a question, Carol? It's Kath here.
Yes, sure.
I just wanted to check, when we go in our groups, is Yanis actually putting us each in a group, or do we have to click on something to sign into one of these groups?
There should be an option to join a breakout room, which comes up as Yanis makes it. And if you click on that, then you'll be able to go into the room. And then I will just say, when you leave the room at the end of the time, just be careful that you don't click on leave meeting. I've done that before. It'll give you the option to leave room or leave meeting. So select the leave room option.
Thank you so much.
All right, I'm going to start it now. Palesa and Lorraine, I'll see if I can add you to the breakaway groups. Let's see. I just want to know if you were able to join groups, Elizabeth and Vinayagi. Sorry, I don't know how to pronounce your name. And Lorraine.
Oh, sorry, I was having problems in logging in, so I don't know how far they've gone with the discussions.
Oh. Okay, I'll assign you again. I see your name is here, so I'll assign you to room 5.
Oh, five.
I think we're going back to the main thing. I think that's what's happening.
Just as much as we can. Then we're going back. So, they stopped us.
Hello, everybody.
They stopped us.
Oh, stopped automatically.
We're just enjoying it so much.
Good.
Also, I don't think that was a fair 20 minutes, but.
Well, I hope it's we can't develop an entire course evaluation within 20 minutes, but I hope that it's at least given you some thoughts on how to do things differently and how you might do things differently. And the Google Doc will still be there, so it could be interesting to carry on this exercise beyond our time. There we go. Can you guys see my screen of the Google Doc?
Yes, we can.
Okay. So sorry to have cut you short, but I think, you know, there is value in us discussing kind of some of the differences across here. So if we're looking at one being relatively low for being included and four or five being high for being included, I'd be interested. There seems to be some debate about including. I feel that I have grown personally in the course, so I'm not sure which group would like to kind of start and put forward some ideas about why you would or you wouldn't be so keen to include this, or what do you think of it? Anybody?
Yeah, thanks, Carol. This is Scott. We were in group four. I was just the scribe putting down the numbers. So I can say that we really hit strongly on this question. I feel that I have grown personally in the course, being that's quite student-centered, and that that at the beginning of the course, one would even lay out some goals that are possible and some things that you might want to achieve and meet with students, discuss that, and then come back at the end to say, you know, have they done that? And you'd want to make it a point of your curriculum to include that. We were actually reviewing a course that Nika Rafi teaches, and she was just commenting that she doesn't include that now, but that this evaluation kind of caused her to reflect on then what content could be in the course, you know, to be student-centered, to kind of meet that evaluation question.
Okay, cool. So you guys were almost linking it to this statement down here of the student setting goals for themselves during the course. And would
yes, okay. They both kind of link together because we found some of the questions a bit similar, but those two definitely, if you're growing and meeting your goals, would be nicely linked.
Okay, cool. Group one, you seem to have a bit of a different take.
Okay, I just want to say that we decided that it was a very similar question to the course was personally meaningful to me.
Okay. So you were,
even though
you were,
one is material and one is not, and felt that maybe you had to start with the more general one first.
Okay, so you were kind of choosing between the two statements which seem to indicate meaningfulness. Mm. Yeah, okay, cool. And let's pick up on this one, because this is an interesting one about group three and group four, and seem to have different levels, and group one was unsure. So what did you guys think of the statement here?
Hi, Scott again from group four. We actually rated this high to start, but then lower down there's another question that's similar, and we like the wording of that much better. We got a little bit hung up on the word attraction between students.
So I'm on the one. I will admit that when I was reading the original article and I saw some of the wording, I was like, this may not be the best wording for like the 21st century. Yeah. With attraction between students. And also felt like, and this is very irreverent of me to say, but the statement of I was influenced by other students and I influenced other students. I was kind of, you know, thinking, what exactly are you influencing? So that might need a bit of a work in terms of incorporating it. But so this one, Scott, is about, I feel the instructor has the right to his or her professional status and opinion, where you guys had rated this one as 1 and group 3 had rated it as a 3 to be included.
Carol, can I come in?
Yes, go for it.
So the course that we're talking about, we're giving them frameworks and trying to get them confident and applying them. So it's not so much what's my opinion. It's you know, here are the tools. What do you want to do with them? So and it's also quite accessible, interactive course. So we try and diminish the status bit. I don't know if that makes sense.
Okay. So, I mean, this might then, you might actually want to switch the question around. I mean, if we remember Foster's original inclusion of this question, it was around the legitimacy of the authority from the instructor or the lecturer. So perhaps rephrasing the question around, I feel the instructor has the right to...
Carol, can I come in here for a second? Mm-hmm. Kath, what bothered our group, I mean, you'll see that we put a question mark mm-hmm. because we felt like it was translated from Russian or some other language. Mm-hmm. We didn't think the word right was the correct word. We thought we were interested in whether the students felt that the educator or instructor, we don't like the word instructor either, mm-hmm. was had capacity and was legitimate and that there was mutual respect. But we didn't mm-hmm. think that this question fully addressed that. Because it's like we are asking if a person has a right to their status and opinion. And I mean, in South Africa, it would kind of be illegal for anyone to say, no, you don't have a right to. So the rights-based language seemed off. Mm-hmm. And then the professional status one is different from opinion. So you're joining two things with a conjunction that are different.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you definitely on joining the two things. And I think... and obviously I agree with you on the language as well. I think though that, you know, what this is trying to get to, you use the word capacity. And I think to me, capacity would more be the expert power that Foster spoke about, that the person is recognized as an expert in their field. And I was thinking about this before the workshop, and to me that's different to the person being seen as a legitimate educator for the course because of the role that's been entrusted to them. And that role might be entrusted because they're an expert, or it might be entrusted, if you're looking at a different curriculum framework to ours, because they're actually not an expert. If you look at some of the PBL facilitators across the world, they're chosen because they are not experts in those fields, but they are able to facilitate sessions very well. And I do think it's important for us to distinguish between that expert role and the legitimate role, because when you look at the article, and I found this extremely interesting, but when they did the factor analysis, this statement here, I believe the instructor knows his or her subject well, which would actually be speaking to that expert authority or expert base for authority. This one wasn't actually associated with any of the factors which were seen to be relevant to the construct of student-centeredness. So I do think that it's something that we need to think about, definitely the wording, and how we word it so that we're actually assessing the construct that we think we're assessing. Mm. So I don't know if anybody else has any ideas on that one about how you would reword it or what you would want to include.
Nika has something in the chat. She's spoken about deserving respect for their skills and expertise.
Okay. Sorry, I have lost track of the chat. So right to his or her expertise. Okay. I mean, their skills or expertise, those could be educator deserves respect for their skills or expertise. Yes, that could be a good way to go.
I would say respect.
Yes. Yeah. So that could be one way in which we could adapt these statements to our context better and to, you know, 2021 rather than 1974, a bit better.
Yeah. Carol, can I ask, like, what would we do if a student, even if we reworded it to the way that Nika and others are suggesting, which I think is really good, but let's say we did put the new wording in, what would we gain from, and how would we figure out what the person who answered this meant if they answered no? So what would that teach us, and what would we do with that? Unless we have a whole lot of unpacking in a sense.
Yeah. So I think part of this to me is that obviously we'd need to pilot any items which we did develop to see that students are interpreting them in the same way as us. To me, if the wording of the question is in a way that that we know it's speaking to the construct that we have, that the students are recognizing the legitimacy of their facilitators or educators or whoever, and they were to say no, I would then start thinking about, okay, so what is the impact then on the classroom environment if the students are not viewing the facilitators as legitimate? Because while a student-centered curriculum, the students have control over their learning, that doesn't mean that it's a free-for-all. It doesn't mean that it's completely unregulated. And so the facilitator has an extremely important role and needs to be viewed as legitimate in order to guide the students towards I don't want to say learning activities, but to learning that will best achieve the skills and competencies that are required. I'm not sure if that's too foggy a statement or if people are still with me. You know, let me stop there. Anastasia, I'm sorry.
Yeah. My thoughts are, I'm just wondering, this class environment, maybe the level at which the students are, where they've also perceived their own agency. If it's undergrads, first year, they're still trying to get their wits about what they're there for, as opposed to final years or postgrads. I think then they will be able to understand this question and be able to apply their hearts or their thoughts to, if the instructor has, has the respect or has the right to his professional status and opinion. So my thoughts are that some of these questions will depend a bit on the level the students are to be able to get a very good evaluation. Mm. I don't know, just thinking.
I partly agree with you, Anastasia, but I think it's also really important that we need to train the students in the educational philosophies that we are infusing maybe and infiltrating through our courses. It's been one of the massive problems within the GEMP program when we had PBL from the third year, is that our first and second year medics were, when they entered university, they came into a didactic curriculum which was very teacher-centered, very focused on recall and remembering. And then there was supposed to be the switch for them at third year into a problem-based curriculum, which was student-centered and where students drove their own learning and determined their own objectives. And their course wasn't exactly set up that way because we still had lectures and there was still a heavy didactic framework with teachers setting objectives. But it made this very difficult for the students to accept the PBL process because they didn't see why they needed to do it if they could learn things from lectures. And so while a first year would definitely not be able to do a student-centered curriculum and they'd need a lot of assistance and facilitation to be able to take part in the activities. I shouldn't say take part in the activities, but take part in the process. I think it's really important for us to consider this right from the start. How do we start the students off as we want them to end, with those methodologies which are going all the way through? And I think if we do give the students the ability to make decisions and take ownership of their learning, as with anything, we need to train them on how to do that and how to approach it, both overtly and through the hidden curriculum. Sorry, I'm talking way too much for this. Yes, Nika.
I like what you're thinking, Carol, but I do, I mean, because I really interact with GEMP 4s when they're pretty nearly cooked. And I think it's difficult in medical school because whether or not they start with 2 years of didactic, they do say that they feel very constrained and that there's a lot of hypocrisy because we ask them to take agency and express critical thinking, but actually they just have to conform and jump the hoops. And I remember thinking that in medical school. So I do think medicine is challenging because there is an anthropological element to conforming and showing willing. And I think we can't, if we rhapsodize too much about, you know, giving them ownership and stuff, I think the articulate ones will push back.
Yes, I agree with you, Nika. And I also, Charlene, I've just read your comment and I agree with you as well. I mean, I always, at the time of Fees Must Fall, I found it amazing because I had colleagues who would say the students must do what I expect them to do. And we had just given them a whole section on advocacy. And the students, we may not agree, or we may agree with how they went about Fees Must Fall. But essentially it came down to them advocating for students who, you know, were being financially excluded. And I just found that a bit of a contrast. So I definitely agree with you. And especially in medicine, there is a push to conform. But I also do have clinicians who say to me that they wish the students could take more initiative or the interns could take more initiative. And I wonder where that balance is. Where does it lie in what we're doing and how we are teaching our students to learn and navigate their own learning? So yeah, I think in every context, we need to think carefully and we need to consult and discuss how things might work. And again, I'm talking way too much, so forgive me for that. Yes, Nika.
I mean, when I see them, we need to be very explicit about the rules of the game and what they are and aren't allowed to do, because they feel like they get disciplined a lot. And so if we give them permission to voice opinions and that, then we have to draw it out of them. But once they settle into it, they quite enjoy it. But they really, they talk a lot about being punished if they say things that Yumi doesn't want to hear.
No, I've heard a similar thing before. So we do need to come to a close. We haven't really gone through many of the statements, but I hope that this gives you an idea of where to start, in how to, you know, start looking at curriculum reviews, and assessing your curriculum or evaluating how your curriculum can be made more student-centered. And Yanis has asked us just to do a checkout activity. So if you could type in the chat in a few words or sentences, what did you find valuable about this session? And what do you think is the way forward in terms of using this information for your course or program evaluations? And I'll put this article, which was the one I referred to earlier, I'll put it into the chat for those who would like to read it. So Nika, I don't know what happened there. I will try to put it in again. Nika, to create an evaluation for your teaching, I would suggest that you chat with Shira Mach from the Center for Health Science Education. CLTD has a platform called Blue Explorance, which can be used to do course evaluations, but it is relatively limited in terms of how they can adapt the platform. You can select items that you want, but again, a number of those items are quite student-centered, teacher-centered, sorry. So I would suggest chatting with Shira. CLTD can design an entire evaluation for you if you want them to. So that can also be a way to go forward. To be honest, what I do is I've got a Microsoft form that asks them what I want them to ask. But it, please do remember that idea about the validity of the statement, and then it would be very useful to chat to others about, you know, and pilot your statements to see that they are actually asking about what you want to ask them about. Okay. Yanis, over to you.
Thank you so much for your interesting session. So next week would be our first session on the e-portfolio. And it's basically just an introduction to using or creating a teaching portfolio, why it's important and so forth, and then taking you through the tech that you can use. So yeah, next week's session is would sort of be just an overview session, and after that we'll start building our teaching portfolios. Just a reminder to sort of put in the chat your answers that Carol asked for the checkout activity, and hope you have a wonderful afternoon, and thanks again, Carol.
Pleasure, Yanis, and thank you, everybody. I hope it was useful for you.